Dit is Papa Alpha 0 Echo Tango Echo voor de Daily Minutes nummer 1120 met een uitzending voor vandaag, 29 oktober 2017. Dit is het bulletin van zondag. Today's bulletin will be in English. De uitzending van vandaag is in het Engels. Vandaag nieuws met internationale relevantie door WIA in Australië. In het eerste deel enkele nieuwsberichten, daarna een bespiegeling in brede zin over de geschiedenis van onze hobby en de gevolgen daarvan voor de toekomst. Today some news with international relevance by WIA in Australia. After that, David Ford, VK4MZ, reflects on the rich history of our hobby within a broader context and its implications for the future.
From Australia, this is VK1WIA and the weekly WIA amateur radio news service.
And news of CTU's Secretary General comments on amateur radio. Bernadette Lewis, Secretary General of the Caribbean Telecommunications Union, was interviewed during the ITU's World Telecommunications Development Conference 2017 in Buenos Aires, Argentina. When asked how crucial is information and communication technology, that's ICT, in assisting countries to implement disaster risk reduction measures, Ms. Lewis replied that ICTs are critical to the process in terms of the preparation, even as the disaster is happening, and in the recovery. We've been contemplating the role of amateur radio. For example, they've been a staple, a significant element of the communications that takes place during and immediately thereafter, and I think that in the Caribbean we need to cultivate a new generation of ham operators. I don't know if this is a situation across the world, but we absolutely need to do that. And you can see more on that on the IIRU Region 2 website, and the link for that's in the text edition.
Norway's National Amateur Radio Society, NRRL, report that they are now recorded in the Common Resource Register used by the main rescue centres and the police. Part of the NRRL report reads, "A Common Resource Register, which is used by, amongst others, the main rescue centres and the police, for an overview of the operational resources that can be used in various events, has been developed. The operational resources of NRRL are now registered in this registry, and the authorities can therefore easily get an overview of what hams can deliver in different crisis situations. In resource registers, resource owners and resource users exchange data on their capabilities and get an overview of available resources. By insight and common understanding of situations, resources can be exploited efficiently, and one can achieve significant time savings." The FCC has affirmed a huge fine of more than $400,000 on a Queens, New York man who has admitted to making unauthorized transmissions on New York City Police Department radio frequencies, maliciously interfering with officers' communications. The FCC had sent a notice of apparent liability last April 14th to the perpetrator, age 20, who's alleged to have transmitted false bomb threats, false claims of criminal activity involving firearms, false distress calls from purported New York Police Department officers, and threats against individual NYPD officers. The unauthorized transmissions began in 2016, according to the FCC, and the FCC has calculated the precise forfeiture at $404,166. Now, wireless weather. Try some 50 megahertz skeds during the lightning season. This is what the SARL is saying in their recent news bulletin. The Johannesburg area apparently is renowned for their late afternoon lightning storms, so this seems to be a great time to experiment with lightning scatter propagation. Of course, only stations outside the lightning area would be able to participate, as those inside the area will have their antennas grounded, or at least they should be anyway. Clear FM broadcasting signals have been heard for about 10 seconds or so over distances of about 450 kilometres after lightning flashes during a distant thunderstorm. Skeds are being arranged in South Africa with amateurs outside the thunderstorm area, making brief CQ calls after a lightning flash or radio burst, and listening during the next burst, and so forth. It would be interesting to find out how directional the ionised trails of lightning are. So, who would take up the challenge and establish that first lightning scatter contact on 50 megahertz?
Hello from David Ford, VK4, Mike Zulu. The more things change, the more they stay the same. Today, I bring you some thoughts on the future of the hobby. Heinrich Hertz proved the existence of radio waves in 1888, or in those days, Hertzian waves, and soon after, with the aid of his assistants, Guglielmo Marconi began to conduct experiments in his attic. At the time, Oliver Lodge had predicted that radio waves would only transmit up to 800 meters. As people experimented with radio, they gathered together to share ideas, equipment, their successes, and their failures. They formed ad hoc groups that worked towards a common goal. Even Marconi, after sharing ideas with fixed wire telecoms technicians, learned a trick. That by grounding his shack, he could extend the range of his transmissions. In the process, he destroyed the common convention of a limited 800-meter transmission range by transmitting over 3.2 kilometers. Within a couple of years, his experiments had taken the range out to 6 kilometers, then 16 kilometers, and from there, the hunt for DX was on. His first message was either accidental or profound. It was simply, "Are you ready?" With that message, he changed the future of communications. A few years later, we see the first amateur radio experimenters coming together and forming groups, like the Wireless Institute of New South Wales and the now Amateur Radio Victoria. Fast forward some 75 years to the 1970s, and we see a groundswell around the personal computer. A similar story ensues. Groups form and collaborate to propel the technology forward. Ed Roberts and Forrest Mims bring to market a kit for a PC which can be built at home, the Altair 8800. Inspired by the Homebrew Computer Club, Steve Wozniak and Steve Jobs begin collaborating and building the Apple I. At the same time, Paul Allen and Bill Gates build the basic interpreter for the Altair PC kit. From there, they build Microsoft. Again, hobby groups form to share ideas, equipment, and to experiment. Humans have a natural percentage of the population who find pushing the boundaries of technology exciting, and sharing the experience accelerates results and makes it more rewarding. They form groups that prosper. 20 years later, in the 90s, it was the explosive expansion of the internet and a similar pattern forms. Hobbyists collaborate, form ad hoc groups, and share experiences and goals. The same thing occurred around mobile technologies and open source software, and there are countless more examples. It is a time-tested trend. When it comes to experimenting with technologies, like-minded people working together towards a common goal always has and always will exist. It is an inevitable part of human nature and the progression of civilization. It's fun and exciting. It is the reason why many of our WIA-affiliated clubs were set up in the first place. Deloitte published a paper in 2013 summarizing the impact of the maker movement. It predicts that the maker movement will be a high proportion of the future workforce, and that the maker movement is more influential in delivering market-transforming innovation than corporate-led initiatives. Today it is the maker groups, Fab Labs, Hackerspace, Hack Labs, and Men's Sheds groups that take the lead. Hackers in these communities are not always someone that manipulates systems to perform nefarious and illegal activities. They are instead someone who can manipulate systems to do something out of the ordinary that they want them to do, typically with very positive outcomes. For example, Topher White of Rainforest Connection uses recycled mobile phones to monitor for illegal chainsaw activity across thousands of acres of rainforest to effectively reduce deforestation. Let's step inside one of these groups to understand how they form. Seabase in Berlin is regarded as one of the oldest communities in existence. It started from 17 people getting together to discuss ideas, work on projects together, and advance their collective skills relating to computer software, hardware, and data networks. They started to meet virtually in chat rooms and bulletin boards, and eventually gathered enough following to secure their own premises in Berlin. Here, they hold events, workshops, training sessions, run projects, and competitions. Seaspace was the birthplace of a political party that won 8.9% of the vote in the 2011 Berlin state election, granting them 15 seats in parliament. The groups form on their own. They are self-managed. They do not comply or operate according to an overseeing body. They move from meeting virtually through email and in private residential premises to having their own space. As a grassroots movement, securing space is a monumental step. In the USA, there is a company, TechSpace, that has commercialized the movement by charging for access to space and equipment to build DIY projects in a shared and supported environment. The current price for membership is between $125 and $180 US dollars per month. They have 10 locations across the USA and are expanding at a high rate. Marketing amateur radio to non-amateurs is like marketing features instead of benefits. Features only work with prospects that already understand them. Amateur radio is the hobby, the feature, but the benefit is working together on building and exploring exciting technology. At the most recent IARU meetings, where they discussed growing the hobby, the feedback from youth observers was that the group should be supported to self-manage and self-organize, that they valued autonomy. Also, activities that were competition-driven were shown to resonate most strongly with younger groups and cause them to gather around a common cause. The Rotary-sponsored Rotaract group caters for 18 to 30-year-olds and is intentionally set up as being self-managed and self-governed. For Rotaract, Rotary merely facilitates as an umbrella organization. Rotaract has almost 10,000 clubs, 300,000 members, and 180 participating countries. So, is this the future? The WIA and affiliated clubs facilitating and hosting self-governed groups and clubs to meet physically and virtually? Facilitating the sharing of experiences, projects, and equipment in pursuit of common goals, pushing the boundaries of technology, using modern communication techniques to rally, build communities, support interest in the hobby, and explore new areas. Is it the future? Perhaps. Feel free to send feedback via email to vk4mikezulu@wia.org.au. This has been David Ford with a few thoughts. Have a great day.
Daily Minutes zijn dagelijks vanaf ongeveer 1900 uur te beluisteren via PI2NOS. De uitzending wordt een dag later om 10:30 ochtends herhaald. Alle mail is welkom op het adres x@xdv.me. Dat is ook te vinden rechtsboven aan de webpagina van de uitzendingen www.pa0ete.nl. Dit is Papa Alpha 0 Echo Tango Echo. De Daily Minutes toont iedere dag weer aan de hand van schokkende voorbeelden hoe een hobby mensenlevens kan veranderen. De Daily Minutes komt tot stand mede dankzij de stichting Scope Hobbyfonds.
En microfoon naar de toer.